welcome to the cold, cold world with the cold, cold wars going on, and my 1 week anniversary of having a cold, nasty cold, as I predicted in starting January 1st, 2015. Acceleration of everything, plunging the world into a state of crisis, and where people, agitation, and here it comes, and it's, how's it been so far? Right. So what can we do? Here's a saying: failing to practice is practicing to fail. Failing to practice is practicing to fail. Some say that John Wooden, well, that was one of his favorite sayings, basketball coach for UCLA. Failing to practice is practicing to fail. This is a very good saying. It's very true. Very true. So I gave as much heads up as I possibly could about these times and warned people to must practice, so you gain a familiarity with spiritual teaching. This is all crucial, all important. And just rely on the Holy Spirit to do the rest, and apparently not so many people in the world are that interested in salvation, really, because familiarity with spiritual teaching, especially in regard to time, and you can say time, space, process, and form, is all an illusion. It doesn't exist. It's a fantasy, and it's a trap. Clarity about this is super important. Even if you don't get it, being familiar enough to listen and talk and listen and hear it and stay with it is all important now at this time in the world. As the world lurches towards all sorts of situations of agitation and uncertainty and confusion and ultimately a restructuring into something that emphasizes time and bodies and space and process and form. This is not a good thing, and this is not a good situation for anyone, actually. So it's a very perilous situation we're in the world right now. Perilous as far as the most important issue is our, how we, what do we believe in terms of time? Is this belief correct or incorrect? Is it mistaken? Can we get free of this? This is crucial. Absolutely crucial. There's some books up here. I put some books up here. Journey Beyond Words, Spaciousness, Longchenpa's Treasure, The Dharma Datu, and Course in Miracles, combined volumes. These are three of the best books, teachings, contain teachings about time, the belief in time. And as Jesus says, time is the grandest illusion of them all. It is the one that we put all our eggs into that basket of time. So it is supremely helpful to be conversant, easily conversant, with the deconstruction of the belief in time, actually. It's not so easy to just intellectually go in there like you're some sort of whiz kid. It's not like that. By the way, I just found out that 87% of the world's population is younger than I am. 87%. I'm not sure if it's 87% are wiser than I am about time, you know, but they're younger. I'm not sure youngness equals wisdom automatically, you know. There's probably a lot of distractions that young people say, look at this, I can do it all. And later on they realize, oh, I'm not really getting anything done, because if we do not truly evaporate our belief in time and the continuity fear that goes with this, we haven't done anything, actually. We've just reinforced a delusional belief is what we've done. So yeah, there's this website, you plug in your date of birth, where you're born and everything, and it comes back and tells you exactly where you stand in the world as far as population 87% of the world is younger than I am. Wow, that's really an amazing statistic. Because I feel pretty much just in the middle, you know, middle demographics of the world. No, 87%. That means only 13% of the world is older than I am. 13%. This is astonishing. I'm only 58. So, only 13% of the world's population is over the age of 58. Maybe that's part of the problem. It is possible, as you get older, as you go through a lifetime of effort, you can become very wise, ultimately. But wisdom is often wasted on the youth. The youthful energy and enthusiasm and curiosity and everything, it just sort of overwhelms us here. And we believe that, I can make anything work out in my favor. It's not a problem. It's not a problem, really. But belief in time, space, process, and form is a big problem in terms of it's not true. It's absolutely not true. I completely agree with Jesus, with Longchenpa, with Ramana Maharshi, with Sri Sri Anandamayi, and other teachers. I completely agree when it comes to, you know, time. Saying what their teachings are, that it's not real, it doesn't exist, it's a fantasy. We're completely free even this instant. There's no such situation as time whatsoever, actually. So I'm 100% on board with that. Totally into that. This is the heart of consideration. So what's the mean age of the world? It's like 32 or something like that. Average age of the world, 32. I don't know. It's very young though. So we have all these young people voting, and following, trending, this, and that. You know, is that a good thing? Anyway, we have the situation unfolding now. And how do we respond to it? Now, the Holy Spirit has given me a way to respond to this. And it's a shortcut. And we need a shortcut now. And it's a shortcut that maybe not a lot of people will use because it seems too drastically to dismiss time. But in my case, I say, you know, sure, why not? And that is to say, I'm already enlightened. Which is true, we're all enlightened, meaning none of us are bound by time because time doesn't exist. Process doesn't exist, space doesn't exist, form doesn't exist, actually. So, we are actually in an enlightened condition, all of us. We just have to accept the fact we are. So when we say it's too late for all of this thinking and worrying, I'm already enlightened. This doesn't bother me at all. I don't need to think about any of this stuff that's going on. I don't need to think. I'm already enlightened. But this does, it just short circuits the whole ego, just like that. One moment. Okay. This new practice short circuits the ego. It really does. It just, that's it. It's the end. I've started to practice this. It's been several days now, and the practice is pretty feeble, but I go to it for a while, and then I drop it for a while, and then I go back to it. The thing is, to go back to it, it takes will, because there's no point in inner dialogue where you can get into it. You just have to look at it and say, hey, I'm already enlightened, I don't need any of this, and just drop the whole thing, just everything, without even following any thought or concept or train at all. Nothing. It's just this, whatever this is, I don't need it. It doesn't affect me. I'm enlightened. I'm not affected by anything. And then just imagine you're in the state where nothing bothers you whatsoever. And there's no reason to take thought for anything. No reason to judge, whatever. You're enlightened. You are in a state of, you feel perfect. And so the turmoil of the world, just, you know, thinking about, wow, you know, Russia has just cut off gas to Europe, you know, and then just transiting out of the petrodollar to the ruble, and, this is like catastrophically, moves on the chessboards, oh my God, and just drop, none of that matters because I'm enlightened, and nothing bothers me, everything is perfect, I feel perfect, so how can anything be wrong? I'm part of the absolute holy harmony of oneness. I'm an integral part, beautiful part, perfect part of the holy harmony of oneness, the absolute perfect harmony. I already am that. So there's nothing wrong with how I feel, or anything could possibly go wrong for me. I'm already that way. So you just drop the whole complex of the world, just boom, directly. Now, again, this requires faith and nerve and wisdom and whatever, I could see how it's not easy. This is what I recommend, though, for those of us who have prepared, because the world is going to get a little too juicy for all of us right now, actually. It already is, isn't it? So, what world? I don't need a world to be what I am at all. I don't need a world at all. Completely enlightened, completely perfect. I don't need anything at all in terms of just to complete what I am or to judge that I am what I am. And these issues don't even arise for me at all. I'm enlightened. I already know the truth. So there's no reason for me to keep thinking, what is the truth? What is the truth? I'm not sure. No reason. I already know the truth. And this is true. It is true. Absolutely, it's true. And this one has to realize that time has never existed. We've always been perfect and complete, and this has just been a dream. So we basically say that I'm perfect and complete. I don't need any dream at all. It doesn't matter what form a dream takes. No difference whatsoever. I'm not going to judge between different forms of a dream takes. I'm just going to drop the whole dream this instant right now. Don't need it. So this is the shortcut. This is the shortcut. If people are wondering, what is the shortcut? Is there some shortcut we can take now that, everything is coming unglued as we have told, warned people that it would. And it's been gaining momentum, more and more momentum. You had to see the writing on the wall. It will continue to unravel. You got this Pope character, playing the Pope, who says the most amusing things. He says, if someone insulted my mom, I'd punch him in the mouth. So in other words, attack is justified if someone insults your mom. Well, really, Jesus says that attack is never justified. Attack is never justified. Right here in A Course in Miracles, attack is never justified. And also the Pope says, you can't, freedom of expression ends with religious sensitivity. And really, everybody has sensitivities, right? I mean, then, everyone's got a religion then they're sensitive about, right? It's nonsense. It's funny. Jesus has been sent through, the most scathing criticism and distortion and hatred and mockery and all this stuff. What did he do on the cross? He said, forgive them, for they don't know what they do. And he told the Peter, just put down your sword, don't defend me. No, see, this is truth. Attack is never justified. Never, never, ever is attack justified. Time doesn't exist, actually. So the belief that time in time also is a belief in attack and sensitivity and upset and all this kind of nonsense. But then again, as this builds up, you just drop it all. So I don't need any of this. I'm already enlightened. I don't even need to think about this. I'm enlightened. I'm pure joy. Fortunately for all of us, and none of us have a spiritual mother, so we can't have any excuse to punch someone in the nose, right? Yeah. We're spirit created by God, which is spirit idea. There weren't two ideas producing us the idea of spirit. No, just one idea. God, from God comes spirit. It's not God and goddess. There's not two realities. There's not two co-creators. There's not two. No, there's one. We can't use that as an excuse. But the more they insult Jesus, the more we respect Jesus. The world is now in a frenzy of rejecting Jesus in a lot of ways. And we just say, wow, what a great teacher we have. You know, who's still bringing the juice to the world and telling us the truth about our belief system of time, how it's completely false. Who's not pulling any punches, who gives us the absolute abstract truth, just as it is. And so, I just feel sorry for those who you know, mock that. Because knowing it's a continuity fear, they have severe continuity fear resolve. So there's no outrage or, you know, upsetness or anything like that. It just means, hey, I think I need to work a little more effectively here because, you know, the ship is sinking. I remember someone, Journey Beyond Words, or someone online was just attacking it viciously, just absolutely attacking Jesus in the lesson. And I looked at it and said, wow, yeah. Amazing. Yeah, someone, yeah, okay, all right, that's their opinion. They're just temporarily suffering from excessive continuity fear. And I know that the Holy Spirit will turn them around without question. And someday they will be, you know, the prime advocate of truth. At some point we all become prime advocates of truth, every one of us. So if you see that, why get angry at anybody? So this one is going to be a, you know, prime advocate of truth very soon, you know, sooner than we think, maybe. So just thank them for what they're going to do. Thank everybody for what they're going to do. They're going to drop insanity for sure, everyone. So why hold back thanks when you know something, someone's going to do something in advance, you already know it? Why hold back thanks from them right now? That's playing the time game. Does that mean I should thank the Giants for winning another World Series this year? I can't say that. You never know with them. So, but as far as being prime advocates of truth and setting insanity down, setting belief in time down, all of us for sure are going to do that. The Holy Spirit tells us we've all already done it. The Holy Spirit sees us all, does not see time at all. The Holy Spirit doesn't see time at all. It sees us all, it's timeless. It knows that we certainly set down a false belief in time, all of us. So we've all done it. Why should we hold back thanks right now? Why? would just be an honoring of time to do that, but we're honoring something that doesn't exist there, so we're honoring our creativity. But how creative is it to just imagine that something doesn't exist, that imagine it does exist? It's not really, you know, that creative. It's just kind of silly. So a question again, knowing that everyone is going to be a tremendous pure advocate of truth and set all insanity down sooner than we know, why hate anyone? Let's say someone went down to a car dealership and bought you a car. They haven't delivered it yet. It's going to be delivered in like in a couple days. Are you going to like hate on them and say, wow, you're a terrible, horrible person. You know, I can't stand. Oh, you just bought me a car. When did you buy it? Well, a couple days ago. Oh. So. Everyone is going to be a prime advocate of truth. Sooner or later. Maybe a lot sooner than we know, so look at the world that way. It's a new way to look at the world. So we live among absolute saints. Yeah. Everyone on the planet is an absolute saint, actually. And from the standpoint of the Holy Spirit, they've already accomplished this. So there are absolute saints now, actually. Why do we have to wait to feel that we're living amongst perfect saints? Why do we have to wait? This is a good question. I'm going to just let this question sit there, like, and wow, this is just a big wow. Obviously, it has to do with completely changing how you view everyone on the face of this planet. So, yeah, if that's not a big wow, I don't know what is. So, full stop in this wow here. You see someone today who's completely confused and has no idea what's going on, and realize, actually, quite soon, they will be crystal clear and be able to give you perfect teaching about the non-existence of time and about truth. They absolutely will. Absolutely will. So I have to reevaluate all our relationships, and don't ever buy into the belief that there's any exception to that whatsoever. There is absolutely not. Look at St. Paul. St. Paul was a nasty character, wasn't he? Supposedly had some Christians put to death. He was the chief prosecutor of Christians, followers of Jesus, chief prosecutor. He was a radical son of a gun. So look what happened to him, you know, completely flipped around. Supposedly it was genuine. Now he may have seen which way the tide was turning. or saw this opportunity to market something or whatever. But he, it's an example of someone who saw the light, so to speak. Dramatic turnaround here. He didn't stop him from believing a lot of stuff the Pharisees believed in, and they kept, he still believed in a lot of that stuff, and tried to fit Christianity into that, you know, into that mold, which we now know is not the correct mold to fit it into. Jesus came to bring a new testament and said, don't put new wine into old wineskins. They're not supposed to put a new testament into the old testament. And that's been a big mistake that many have made. Doesn't fit properly. You lose the essence of it. You try to do that. So Jesus came back and said, hey, this is more what I was getting to. This is A Course in Miracles, Journey Beyond Words. This is what I was, you know, trying to get you, point you towards, okay? And time is no more beautiful book than Journey Beyond Words. You know, it's an absolute all-time epic, classic, all-timer, you know, without any question. I read it and reread it just a little bit, and just the adamancy. You've never heard anyone speak so adamantly in your life. This is what I love about it. This is someone who's speaking from certainty. Real certainty. You don't hear anyone speaking this way in this world as Jesus speaks in Journey Beyond Words. Cuts right to the chase and just says, spills the beans. Here it is. And we're just not used to that. We just say, wow, we're not supposed to be certain here in this world, right? We're trying to accommodate both truth and lies and saying, well, we're not sure they can be both true, but so we're just trying to be fair. And oh, Jesus says, no, they cannot be both true. Only truth is true. Nothing else can be true. And so he speaks from certainty. So it's this certainty that is like the strongest wine there is. I mean, people waste their time with alcohol and drugs, stuff. What a waste of time. You know what you're trying to prove? You're some, you know, you're into the hard stuff. You can handle the hard stuff. Yeah, I remember all the people. Everyone had status. So many people had status according to what, you know, what kind of drugs and they could handle and things, stuff like that. How much could they drink and just, you know, how messed up they could be and how they could just, you know, have an altered consciousness and you know, that. So, but all that stuff is like the weakest tea, you know, compared to the jolt you get when you read Journey Beyond Words. This is the real hard stuff. You want to go on the real, you know, big person ride. Take a look inside that book, and see, start paying attention to that. You can't touch that. Drugs cannot touch that in terms of the real buzz. The true buzz is just, wow. How amazing. What is being said is so amazing. It's like music. It's the best music you ever hear. We think we, you know, music aficionados think they've heard all the great music. Well, you listen to this song of salvation that Jesus is singing, and then you know you've really heard great music. that's the real stuff. So, being a child of the 60s, which I certainly am, that incredible time in the world, that epic, that era, where it was absolutely amazing. You know, the real status of a child of the 60s is, you know, to have spent time with the real hard stuff, the real McCoy, the real deal, the true counterculture. Jesus is the real counterculture. Okay. The real Jesus is the real counterculture, for sure. Counter civilization, counter worlds, counter universe, counter time space process form. Counter bondage, slavery, misery, fear. So the 60s, we were all supposed to be, grow up to be wise. That was our mandate. We rejected technology, high technology. We knew it was coming in. And said, no, our exploration is consciousness, awareness, truth, wisdom. We're going to take that path, and we're going to excel at that, because we knew these gadget heads were coming in from gadget land, many incarnations and worlds that are obsessed with a world of things, the gadgets. And monitoring and all this nonsense that they're bringing in, and that wasn't our thing, really. Not the children of the 60s, not really. So fulfilling that, you know, mandate is a great thing to be able to talk about. I wish there's more of us around. It's only 13% are over the age of 58, huh? That's not a lot. But we were looking for what's the real answer? What's the real hard stuff? Whatever it is, we'll take it. You know, we were spiritual adventurers. You know, where's the real stuff? I want to find it. Well, I'm telling you, these books right here, that's finding it. That is finding it, and then applying it. And practicing, that's really finding it. And then the final step is to short circuit the ego completely and just say, I don't need anything. I'm already enlightened. I don't need even a single thought. And just rest on that and just keep saying that, keep practicing that. This is what Jesus recommends, actually. It's a little trick. It's a way to short circuit the ego, yeah? Shortcut, actually. But, you know, the thing about shortcuts is they sound great on paper, but they don't mean anything if you don't do it. Right? So, and everyone would do it if it was that easy, but, you know, you have to really have faith. And know this is true. Otherwise, you'll think, wait, I need those thoughts. I mean, I need to improve myself. Something needs to improve. No, nothing needs to improve. Now, we thought, that children of the 60s, when they gained spiritual wisdom, the world would listen to them. Doesn't seem to be happening, does it? No, very unsettling. But being enlightened, there is no unsettlement whatsoever, and no need to even think about it. You know, I feel perfect. See, this is the shortcut. Just drop, I feel perfect. Right here, right now, I feel absolutely perfect. Without a single question, as far as all the questions, none of that arises because I'm enlightened. And in being enlightened, I'm not even entertaining anything like that. Don't need to entertain anything. So if you have some questions, like someone might ask you, well, how did you get enlightened? I'm enlightened. Such questions don't bother me in the slightest bit. I don't need to even give any thought whatsoever to anything. Whatever responses I need will be perfectly given. I don't have to struggle or think about it whatsoever. I'm already this way. So I don't need to entertain any concerns whatsoever. So for those who are wondering, uh-oh, here comes 215, and they're starting to realize, uh-oh, this is big trouble. Yeah, guess what? We have the tool that we need to overcome it completely. Totally. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God and the Father, the one and only God. The oneness, the perfect harmony, the perfect freedom. Giving us this shortcut. Just, that's it. That's. It's not even done. I'm enlightened. I don't even think of those terms anymore. Did I get enlightened? Or this? No, none of those questions arise for me anymore whatsoever. I don't have those thoughts at all. So since I'm enlightened, I don't have any of these thoughts that keep trying to arise. I don't have them. I certainly don't need to entertain them because I don't even have these thoughts. You see how that's a shortcut? Instead of entertaining these thoughts and trying to dispel them, you just say, I don't have these thoughts. I'm enlightened. These thoughts don't arise for me. I'm already enlightened. I don't have these troubles. These troubles do not arise for me whatsoever. I'm perfect. I feel complete bliss. Now, I certainly hope my brothers and sisters of the 60s can get to this point and use this and be in line, and it will be effective. And everyone else, too. The 87% that are younger. Absolutely. Everybody, please. Anyone who can, please use this technique. It is like giving out the Holy Grail, actually. Maybe this cold was an excuse not to give it out. I may have, you know, double clutched. Yeah, I go up for a jump shot and shoot on the way down. Yeah. So maybe I said, hey, I don't know, this is like too much. It's too much. It puts me too far out there, you know. So maybe I allowed the cold to hit me and gave a nice excuse for it, and boom. Some of it affected my breathing, my throat, voice, and everything. So maybe I haven't been able to speak much and thinking, just giving up taping. It's, you know, what's the use? Nobody's listening anyway, hardly anyone. Thank you, those who are. Thank yourselves for listening. Because you're hearing this technique now. This is something that's not given out generally in books or anything. Jesus just mentions a little blurb. He just drops it in there a little bit. And I've sort of, Holy Spirit has refined it for me and explained it. Yeah. So, I mean, the concerns of not being enlightened, I don't have those concerns. Concerns of how to get enlightened, I don't have those concerns. I'm already enlightened. And again, this is absolutely true. We are already completely perfect and complete, have absolutely no needs whatsoever, absolutely free. We're already that way. Everyone is. We're just dreaming. We're like in the bed. The way to wake up is say, I'm already awake, you know. This dream? No, I'm awake. I don't need dreaming. I don't care what the dream is. I'm awake. I'm not dreaming anymore. I'm not dreaming anymore. This dispels the dream. As I realize, oh, I wake up from it because I'm not following anything in the dream anymore. You see, if we follow anything in the dream, we won't wake up. We won't wake up. But now we're just not following anything at all. I'm enlightened. I don't need to follow anything in a dream. It has no relevance to me whatsoever. Keep in mind that every single one that we see in this world has already been a perfect advocate. Delusion that we have this time. It seems that some are not doing that yet, but they all have actually done it. So this is not too much information for them, and this is something that they love to hear, actually. It's just time, the belief in time doesn't make it seem so. So you can even expand that everyone's already enlightened. Nobody needs these thoughts. I don't need to reinforce, amplify, or broadcast these thinkings and thoughts. Everyone's already enlightened, perfectly so. So when I've been giving out, sharing this information, and you know, I get hit in the throat, I feel suddenly a severe cough tries up, and I was able to push it back. But this time, finally, you know, it got to me. Which just means probably my own fear of sharing this. And then again, you can switch to none of this. I'm already enlightened. Talk of fear, trouble, sickness has no relevance to me whatsoever. I feel perfect. Now, it's not a question of trying to feel perfect. I do feel perfect. I'm not trying. So just drop all effort. Relax your mind, release your thoughts, let them go. I don't need them. I'm enlightened. I don't need a mind full of thoughts on how I got enlightened. I don't need a single one. In my enlightened condition, I don't need to worry about thoughts about how I got enlightened. Just take that on faith that such considerations don't arise. Because I've never not been enlightened. How did the path come to an end? Well, we realized it was at an end. We don't need it. It's always been at an end. But these thoughts too. Don't need these thoughts. Don't need any thoughts. Don't need any thoughts at all. I'm enlightened, perfectly enlightened, and have no need for any thoughts whatsoever. Now, in practicing this, of course, you know, there may be some of you who might just do it, boom, you get it like that. There's always those that possibility. And others might, you know, struggle a bit, and it seems a little feeble at first, like what I'm doing. Yeah, that also is possible. Some might find it, wow, it's really difficult. Might try a little bit and go real carefully. That's fine too. But just a little effort of this, try a little bit, and then you gauge and say, that wasn't so bad. No, it's not so bad. Let me try it again. So that's what I do many times. Let me try it. I'll be going along, thinking about the world, and suddenly, I don't have any thoughts. I'm enlightened. Jesus also, well, I don't know if I could add more onto this or not. Maybe not. And again, we don't have any such thoughts of adding on or not adding on or anything bothering us. We don't have any need for any technique, actually. We're already enlightened. Technique for enlightenment? No, I am enlightened. We don't talk to a technique for enlightenment to what's already enlightened. All of us are already enlightened. just stop paying attention to the dream of unenlightenment. So again, admittedly, this is a shortcut. It's really fantastic, and it's very helpful. Hi. Right now, one moment, please. It's certainly, try it. Again, no matter how feeble, you say, I'm not doing it right, I'm not sure. We'll help, we'll reinforce, we'll help with support, and say, yeah, come, you know, keep at it. I'm just feeling my way along, like, okay, how do I do this? Because I know it's do or die, really, at this time. We need this shortcut now. I knew we'd have to have some great big boost at this time, and here it is. This is the big boost. This is the cruncher. It just crunches time completely. It's the time crusher. It is the time crusher. Just crushes time completely. This instant. And that's it. Nothing more than that. So we did get the big boost. This is not coming in with flowing robes, some goddess with flowing robes and hair and song, and you know, no, it's just very simple. I don't need any thought. I don't have any thoughts. I don't need thoughts. I don't have any thoughts. I'm already thought free. I'm already the thought free guru. I'm already the shining saint. There's absolutely nothing I need to do to establish myself as that whatsoever. Don't need to give a single thought to it. It is already the case. End of story. And just practice it. Now you'll be pulled out of it. Again, you know, go back to it. And during the day, just whatever you can, just drop everything. Say, hey, I'm already the shining saint, the thought-free guru. I'm perfect. I'm already perfect. I don't need any of this. I don't even have any of it. It's not gone. Don't even say, where'd it go? No, it's already gone. I'm already enlightened. And therefore, I have no interest in where it went or how it went or anything. It's no longer interesting me in the slightest bit. I'm in an enlightened condition, where I know everything I need to know already, without any thinking whatsoever. That's already my condition. So, you know, the children of the 60s came here, hasn't been completely complete failure. Giving this out, this information out here at this particular time is a huge success, actually. Gigantic success. Man, I certainly owe a lot of debt of gratitude for all those who came into the world in a similar time frame, and some of those who came afterwards too, for the spirit of, you know, the spirit of spirit, you know, like, hey, you know, there's something that we can do that's going to help. We just have to find out what it is. It's not, technology or anything like that. No, it's not. And something better. Way, way, way better. So, you know, hopefully the Holy Spirit will move in mysterious, wondrous ways. And many will come. And many will begin to practice this. But again, I don't hold my breath one way or the other. I'm beyond trying to figure out what the Holy Spirit will do. I'm enlightened anyway, and none of this bothers me. Right? Already enlightened, so there's no thought of any need to do anything, not troubled by any concerns or worries whatsoever. Don't exist. Well, we'll see what happens. This is the antidote to civilization. This is the antidote to what's going on. This is the antidote to the end times, actually. So, hopefully I can drop this cold now. And now that I'm putting this out there, and say, I can say this, sure, why not? I was one of spirits who would say anything, no matter what. You know, no matter who it was or whatever circumstance, whatever, I would say, I would speak the truth, I would speak my mind, no matter what. So that's where my background that I come from. It's certainly been difficult to speak the truth in this world these times, for sure. Quite a challenge, to say the least. But we're up to it here. We're up to it. Absolutely. Okay. We'll see what else I can add as we go forward. But just let this assimilate and full stop on the wow. I mean, just full stop, like wow. The big boost is here. And it's easier than I thought. It's a shortcut. There is a shortcut. How about that? Very great. That's it.